Welcome back, Sonas, to the 4PL Play for Fame Corsair Vendons Cup September qualifiers number 2. I am Pulse, joined by Spuddington. Good
Hello.
Evening.
It is a good evening. It is evening now. Evening.
The light outside. It's getting there. It's getting to that evening stage. But we will have the first bands being Alistair Malphite, Jace and Rengar, DM Gaming on the blue team and WinFact on the purple team.
Yeah, so Alistair, obviously, we've mentioned a few times now, really strong ganking jungler, great early game, great mid game, pretty solid late too. Malphite, very strong top laner, shuts down AD champions, great hard initiate, very difficult to push out of a lane. Jace, however, is less of a common ban. He is strong in the right hands. He's very difficult to deal with for anyone who only has one gap closer, and obviously disengage, a lot of burst, a lot of poke, a lot of utility too. Very strong character. Rengar is kind of an interesting one. He has a lot of burst in the early levels, but I've seen him fall off like a stone quite often. But maybe it's a targeted ban. Maybe it's just they think WinFact thinks he's more dangerous than we think. And the final two bans are Blitz and Shen.
Yeah, Blitz is a kind of mistake punisher. He's really, really strong. Generally, if you have that picking composition, you get into that CT situation, pull someone, boom, they're dead. Have any CT to back that up, and they are stuffed. And plus the fact he has the Power Fist as well, combine that with any sort of CC, even if it's like a strong slow, it's just like, how are you going to get out of there? And there's very little you can do about it. Shen, global presence, and then plus the teleport as well. Just a late game, you get ahead, you split punch, and then it just gets into that snowbally mess that everybody absolutely hates. But yeah, the first picks will be Karthus, Nunu, Sona, and potentially Ezreal.
So Karthus is obviously that mid character who likes to sit in mid, and then Requiem, gank all lanes simultaneously, picks up gold. Basically, he wants to get huge. He wants to get all the money. He wants to become that late game monster, that real pain in the rear that you just can't kind of deal with, because he'll just charge into the middle of your team, die, and then ruin your shit anyway. Sorry.
Under the watershed.
It was too late. I was like, my brain was saying it before. Yeah, but anyway, Nunu and Sona are interesting picks. Nunu could be going top, could be going jungle. Unlikely to be going support because Sona is there. Sona is obviously very high poke character. Lots of kind of invisible power from her auras. Has that mobility as well. That great ultimate AoE stun. Nunu has obviously is a real pain because he will, if he's in the top lane, he's nigh on impossible to push out because he has consume, which can keep him sustained, especially once he's picked up a revolver. He has ice balls, which will slow you down if you're in at all reliant on AD. Ganks obviously enables ganks very strongly. He's just generally a real pain, and obviously late game he has a bucket load of utility. And yeah. Ezreal is, really strong AD carry at the moment. Great position, great poke, great burst, great attack speed debuff, great everything, basically.
He does all of the things.
Yeah, pretty much.
And we'll have the Taric coming out there as well. So yeah, Taric synergizes well with Ezreal, because if someone could just pin them in place for Ezreal, and anyone would burst. Like, if you pin Ezreal with like anyone who has decent burst, like Taric, like Sona, then it just adds to his killing potential, and that's what you basically have for him. The same with Corki, and same with Gragas, until they were both nerfed and Ezreal wasn't. But yeah, Gragas again with the great mobility and the counter initiate and the engage, just strong in general. Definitely worth the ban sometimes against certain targets, but it's difficult to blanket ban everything. And Ark of God potentially, we'll be picking up the Amumu, and then we will have the Irelia and potentially the Jax. I wouldn't be surprised, because Jax is generally seen as the counter to Irelia, but it can get more even than people expect.
Yeah, I mean, he has that ability to dodge all of her damage, but at the same time, she has Equilibrium Strike if he tries to get aggressive. So it's very difficult lane. It's very, very skill-based matchup. Like, one can get an advantage over the other and start bullying the other one out. Irelia is kind of at a disadvantage from the start, though, I will say. We've got time to look at rune pages, I expect.
We do. And anyone you want to look at particularly?
I'm going to go with Nunu.
Nunu, which would be WinFact Goats.
Goats.
Okay. Goats.
Like runes. Goats.
Ooh, rocking out the Razor Quince. So he's got the movement speed, the 4.5 movement speed, extra attack speed, 24 magic resist, which will be scaling, and the armor plus 13. Moving on to mastery, 0, 21, and 9, going straight down to Juggernaut for the extra health. Initiator, more movement speed, indomitable, but not tough skin. Interesting, reduced damage from minions. And then extra movement speed from the swiftness, going straight down to runic affinity.
I guess he's not taking Tough Skin because he has a very sustained jungle by default anyway. So he doesn't really need that Tough Skin for his early clear. Like, he's better off just getting the armor and the magic resist, which is going to be more relevant later on when he's trying to tank, you know, champion damage.
Yep. So anyway, guys, just going to promote the raffle on the 4PL website, front page, number one on the news. Just follow the steps, click on the link, and you will be in the chance to win a headset. It is a SteelSeries, I believe, so very, very nice. Get your hands on that, show that site some love. And we actually have another 30 seconds, so if you want to check another room page.
A Moomoo, actually.
Phanix, and look at the runes, Chuck Norris. Nice, nice room page. Scaling MR at level 18, 6% rather, spell vamp bonus, interesting, 13 armor and an 8 magic penetration, 8.5, 0.219, exactly the same rune, actually this time taking the tough skin damage from minions and into the bladed armor as well, just because you're kind of just letting the minions wear on you while you deal the damage from your sort of overtime clearing abilities. But anyway, guys, going to jump to a quick commercial break, and when we get back, we'll be in the game between DM Gaming versus WinFact. Stay tuned. Hello and welcome back, guys. We have DM Gaming in the blue corner and WinFact in the purple corner. I am Pulse, joined once again by Spunnington. Hello.
Hello. How's it going?
It is going most fantastically, dear chap.
Lovely. I'm so pleased to be here today that I'm putting on a stupid voice. So, we have looking like, yeah, sorry, DM Gaming, DN, DM?
DM.
DN,
no, LMNOP.
Yeah, are going to be going for, where is Irelia going?
On a voyage of, what the? Kaltar just face planted a wall belly flop. Report, seriously.
There's new blood.
But we need that on the Worth file, just to play randomly in the cast.
Yeah, that seems like a good idea.
Yes.
So, I'm guessing nobody actually saw, although actually Hiryu has, yeah, oh, so okay, Hiryu. So he was in the bush then. Took the damage and Arcane shifted out, maybe? I don't know. He's certainly taken damage from somewhere. I didn't see, but...
He got prodded, but the body flop missed, so he just face-planted, and Ezreal was just like, I'm out. Bye.
So long, suckers.
You belong in a museum.
That's actually going to be... Forcing him to take Arcane Shift is actually going to hurt him when he takes Golems now. I mean, it shouldn't be too big of a concern, but kind of issuous, shall we say. So, yeah. Goats will just be doing his Wolves. Going for blue. Going for probably fast level 3, I'd say. Then he'd probably go for a gank, maybe up top. Because I feel like top lane is probably going to be where the biggest kind of swing happens in the early game. Like, if you can give Jax an early advantage over Irelia, or Irelia an early advantage over Jax, that's going to be making a much bigger difference than if you go for, you know, a later game advantage. And Abumu hasn't used his smite yet, so he's probably going to be going Wraiths, Wolves again after he's cleared his current jungle, then back to red again.
He'll probably might go fast free.
Maybe, yeah. So, yeah, I mean, Namubu usually wants to get to level 6 as fast as possible, though. And,
Goats tried to consume that minion, but Fanix had none of it and just smited it. I was like, yeah, what? Now they're just bumping heads a bit.
Tank fight! But Goats obviously has higher damage, and Karthus isn't really in a position to respond right now. Kautard definitely has a stronger early game, so he's just going to be trying to keep him tied up here. Goats and Fanix still duking it out. You're not taking a red buff, man.
Mid laners will be also following after. Kaltar pretty much out of mana as well, waiting for that Drunken Rage, obviously, to get the mana, but hasn't got it yet, obviously, because he needs the actual damage abilities.
Goats got away with that buff.
Oh, wow, did he smite it?
I don't know, but he certainly got it. And right now, El Mopo is pretty much taking chunks out of Breda. Breda's actually been doing some pretty nice play here. I mean, every time El Mopo tries to counter-strike onto him, he tends to Blade Surge to a minion to get out of the way at the last second. So, very nice play by him, but at the same time, he just can't damage Jax right now. He doesn't... I think, yeah, he's only just picked up Hit End style, and it's not going to be a huge amount of damage right now either. So, that's going to be a difficult top lane for him, basically. But obviously, he's going to do that Irelia thing where you just farm at tower, don't really care. Very cheap, spammable sort of addition to his auto attacks by using Blade Surge to farm. But yeah, easy farm for him. Jax probably won't be taking him out too much. Yeah, 18 farm to 20 actually at the moment. El Mopo is actually behind. And this is something you actually see quite often in this lane. You see Jax trying to get aggressive, but he actually ends up missing out on CS because of that fact. Like, he ends up focusing too much on that. And 6 and Enix actually doing some pretty nasty hurt onto Hiryu and Nastywood. Like, they are definitely behind at the moment. That's really nasty to be dealing with.
Yeah, and you think that's bad? Hiryu has no pots left, and he's been forced out of lane. Meanwhile, Graves, 3 pots left.
Wow, yeah, that's really nasty. And traditionally, you associate a lane with a Taric in it as being kind of a hard, engaged, aggressive lane. But they're staying in, and it's because Thanix is going to be coming in. Probably got bandage toss by now.
Yeah, looking to land it. Oh, Dazzle goes out, but the flash perfectly from 6. Of course, the increased range on Dazzle will make it stun for longer, but if you actually can't catch up to them, and the fact that you were drawing the mountains in the open, where Hiryu cannot actually get in there, that's from Buckshot as well. And Amumu does want this to happen, though. Phalanx is there. Stun goes once again from max range by Nasty Wood, but it's just not enough, and Six is also putting the pain on. Three members of the team on very low health, and Karthus will be picked up for the first blood onto Nunu. If only Karthus was on the other team.
Yeah, Karthus there was dived, actually. He flash-dived Gragas after he knew he was dead anyway, but couldn't quite land the final lay waste to get him out, so yeah, that didn't work out for him. And Elmer Pope still being very aggressive onto Breda. He's just, you know, this is what we mean by Jax having an advantage. But, obviously, Relia is still keeping up on farm, 35 to 35. This is the thing, Jax can win in a fight, but he can't really stop Irelia farming.
Yeah, and obviously the solution to that is killing her, but she's not letting that happen, being very conservative, getting the damage where she can, not letting herself just be poked and nothing returned in turn, I guess. But she's not falling behind, and as you said, staying up in farm. So when it gets to that later phase, where it gets to like level 9, gets to those team fight phases, it'll be slightly better. Here is the potential kill, and there's the straight up from Nunu, getting that slow, and we'll be tanking that as well, and Phalanx just coming in from the side and just taking over the lane more than anything. He can't do anything else. So yeah, the solution, getting the kill.
Yeah, they actually knew that Goats was in that Tribush at top lane, because they pinged it before he came in, but I think they didn't expect him to... I did think they just didn't quite play it correctly. They didn't quite expect Elmopo to get the stun down as fast as he did. Just a very aggressive dive, and obviously Phalanx just wasn't there quite fast enough. And at the bottom, actually, here are you going in on a 6, doing a damage, but they're going to be taking a beating in return. Like, that Taric Ezreal probably has more kind of... I don't know, they have, in a very short engagement, they probably have more damage. But over time, I think Six and Etnix probably have slightly more. It's not a huge difference between either of them, but yeah. They also have more sustain, obviously. Dono probably out-sustains Taric significantly because he can't afford to use Imbue very often. Mana-intensive ability.
If you take a look at the lane, they are pretty much the same thing, and actually Elmopo will be finding the Phalanx in the brush. Kaltar coming in for sides as well. That will be a 3v1 situation. Didn't even manage to smite that for the blue either. Flash goes down into the explosive cast, but Goats snowball to the face. What are you going to do? And a quick pickup there. Meanwhile, boss Mechlex has been stunned. Going in from this initiate, here are you taking a huge amount of damage. Nasty Wood also chasing after as well. Ultimate has gone down, that being the Requiem. Straight onto 6. Huge damage coming out as well. Here are you still chasing after. Autotax coming out with the dupe. And game over. Nasty Wood picking that kill up. Just making sure that here are you was not taken out.
Yeah, and I'm sure here are you right now will be slightly annoyed that that kill was taken, but far more grateful that they now have lane dominance. He can afford to do some catching up, basically. I mean, he actually is already on equal farm to Graves, but having been forced out of the lane, having used more pots, he's been behind a bit. He's not going to have been happy with how the lane's been going thus far, but now, obviously, he's at an advantage. He has a support. Etnix doesn't. Etnix has been forced to pop a lot of pots and could potentially get zoned out, but being at his tower, he's not too concerned right now.
Yeah, it was a very clever engage as well, because they attacked them because they knew at level 6 they're probably going to lose the trade. Okay, they have Burst as well, they have the True Shot Barrage into the Radiance, but the fact that they have the Crescendo, there's the Lockup, which they won't have at level 6, and Graves have the Collateral Damage, it adds to the Burst. You're stopping them with the smokescreen. Dick move!
You got done, son.
But basically, they knew they were going to lose the trade at level 6. They might as well go for the trade there and then. If they lose the trade and one of them dies, okay, just play a passive, farm for the rest of the laning phase. Ezreal has a spammable Q as well, he can just carry on farming at range, come at turret as well, he'll be able to last hit pretty easily as well. But as it was, they went in for that perfect trade, which ended up in a kill for them.
And obviously you see the power of Karthus there, because it means that they can go in for a disadvantageous trade and still come out on top, because that Requiem just tops off their damage. He doesn't even have to take the kills himself for himself. If Karthus just gets the assists and enables kills that wouldn't otherwise have happened, he's going to get strong. He's going to get, you know, nasty, and it's going to help his other lanes too. So, very sensible play, essentially. So Amumu has hit 6, and his ultimate has been up for a little while now, but I guess he just doesn't see many ganking opportunities. Elmopo is spending a lot of time roaming with Goats, and actually he's just picked up red buff from him. And that could be a turning point in this Jax versus Irelia lane. With a red buff, he's going to be a lot stronger. Like, he's going to be able to chase her down where he normally wouldn't be able to. And in fact,
yeah. Goat's looking for that gank. Not going to happen. But, Ward.
Kill.
I'd like to think Roar would be the thought process going through New Year's brain right there, but yeah, that does translate into Ward kill.
Yeah. So, okay. Right now, I think there's, you know, sort of a lull in the action. I mean, Goats might be looking for something in mid. Nah, he's not. He's just going to clear out wards, I expect. He'll leave. He'll be, you know, pretty happy. Keep on farming up. So, this is definitely going to be
Potential initiate coming down on Styx, right at the bottom. Dance X Revolution as well, into the smokescreen. Kind of a blind, actually lands it on the edge of it. On the edge of the two-shot barrage, but they should be out of there. Panics. Oh, we'll actually connect. Flash goes down into the Rec Room as well, potentially pick up the kill into Six. There it is. Arc God picking up a nice and easy Rec Room kill from across the map.
Yep. Spawn pad, Karthus. Yeah. It's basically, like we say, strength of Karthus. You can just sit in his lane, keep farming. Kowtar isn't killing him right now, and he will farm himself up into a late-game monster. I mean, Karthus late game probably has one of the highest damage of any champions. Like, he can walk into your team and output that damage as well. Just extremely powerful.
Yeah, and that's all down to really, like, sustained mages. They get very scary at late game. Like, late game, they just output so much damage, and constantly. It doesn't stop until you obviously kill them or they run out of mana. But it's just like the likes of Swain, likes of Ryze, as you just mentioned, Karthus and Vlad as well. Actually, gank coming down at bottom, however, into the smoke screen. Here are you, just sitting at his tower. Phanax, good juke by Goats, actually stopping that from happening. And Kaltard also going in with the flash body flop. We'll be getting out of the explosive cast, goes down as well. Lands the, actually misses the Q and will be picked up. Here are you, not going to fall to ignite. He will actually fall on the last tick. Arcan God now chasing after Goats as well, who'll be trying to get out of there. Does not have any mana when his Blood Boil wears up. Actually, Blood Boil did actually have enough for that one.
Very cheap to get a spell.
Yeah, it is.
It's 50 mana. So yeah, he'll be out of there. I don't know what was the trade-off there? One for one?
I think so, yeah.
Alright. Well, that's not too bad, I guess.
Commits a lot of people down there, though.
Yeah. It was a large amount of commitment. Now, Mopo trading off against Breda here, and yeah, Breda just can't quite win out. But Elmopo can't quite force her out of lane. It's just a very, very stale lane right now.
Breda will be recalling now.
Yeah. He's kind of taking an advantage at the moment. Now that he's got a phage, he can start to try and bully her around a bit. He could dive this, actually. Goats is coming up as well, and I think Thanix is, also looking for it. And actually, they're going to meet in the jungle here. So they're both aware of each other. Yeah. Hello.
And there's the dive that you're talking about. That'll be the quick kill into the flash. He will be out of there. He knew that the enemy jungler was tied up, so he went for it. He knew he could probably go for the dive himself, and the fact that he has no chance of the enemy actually responding. There you go. You have the kill on top lane. Better take blue buff. And they probably had the timer on that as well. It's just like, okay, we probably need the kill top. We get the kill mid or in the jungle, and that means we can go for the invade.
Yeah, interestingly, he didn't actually use his ultimate for the armor, which you would normally expect on a dive. And I think it was because he didn't actually have the mana. It was very good mana management, essentially, because he didn't risk running out of mana and not having enough for, you know, leap strike or counter, the really key things. But obviously his ult would have helped him to tank that tower a lot more safely, but, you know, played it very well. It shows a lot of forethought, basically, realizing that your full combo is going to run you out of mana.
That being said, Irelia might have thought that she was safe because he didn't have the mana for a full combo. A lot of these top players know exactly how much mana it takes for the enemy to actually output that entire combo. And one way of bypassing that is by having extra mana regen, or in Grove's case, he's actually bought a mana potion. So he goes for that engage. He's like, oh, he doesn't have enough mana for his Bookshot Collateral combo. He pops the mana pop. What can you do about it? And actually, Mumu picking up that Drake while everyone was committed. Nasty with actually engaging with the Radiance as well. Karthus coming in from the side, and Phanix along with Breva are
five
there.
Man dive.
Jax are five man onto two at the moment. That Sector Revolution landing onto two people. NX will surely be picked up in the split second, but the Ghost coming in from the side, giving Hiryu a snowball for the road. Kaltar coming inside as well, just in case they wanted to commit. But meanwhile, atop, Jax.
Elmopo. He's pushing. He's pushing hard, basically, right now. It's very, very difficult for them to... Like, if you've committed five men, you have to get multiple kills or a serious objective, because it's just, the top player, like El Mupo, who knows what he's doing, will push. He'll push hard, and he might take a tower. So you have to weigh it up, basically. Is it worth you going for that, you know, five-man dive on two people at bot and potentially getting a double kill, or would you rather lose your inner tower? Like, you have to do a cost-benefit analysis. And El Mupo might be walking into Arcagod here. Oh, wow, yeah.
And Barrel. There's explosive cast as well. Panic's coming in from the side, but he has been snowboarded. Catch initiation ball. And oh, Raccoon comes down, potentially picking up the kill to Kartar. There it is, one for one trade so far, but Radar coming in from the side as well, force a flash over the wall, and translating the blade just to kind of poke him as they leave. Panic's coming in from the side, however, actually lands the Bandit Tower pretty much out of mana as well. Can he actually follow up on this? He will be out of mana in about 2 seconds. There we go. Tears have been exhausted.
Damn.
Reservoir of tears.
The flow. Yeah, it's, yeah, actually, I think El Mupo probably could have turned around earlier, but they weren't quite sure of where the enemy bot lane was. They weren't quite sure of, you know, just how generally safe it was. And Thanix kind of maybe misjudged that, was going after them for with the potential of a kill, but I don't think he actually had that potential. But, you know. So, anyway, this game is definitely going to be hitting.
Oh, NX does hitting big picks up here. Radiant goes down as well. Here are you looking for massive damage. Six still has... Oh, he doesn't have Crescendo. That's why they went for the engage. They knew it was going to be up soon and just did enough damage to push NX back. Six have... he has a Vamp set, but he's got no pots.
Yeah. Yeah. So, right now I'm trying to think who's going to be the key players in this kind of coming, like, mid-game teamfight stage. And actually, Kowtard coming down, possibly going to hit Taric. Hiryu going to be having an issuous time.
It's coming out, explosive cast goes down, but, yeah. Well, not really achieving very much.
Yeah, that's kind of the thing when you have an inbuilt blink in your kit. You can really screw over you know, an ability that's very dependent on your positioning. You can really try and mess with people's heads. I mean, Gragas could have potentially tried to counter.
Oh, nasty wood. Dance X Revolution into the snowball as well. Massive flow coming out. Agnex following up with the smokescreen as well into the auto attacks. Fenix coming in from the side as well, but actually finished that off with a Hymn of Valor. Fenix looking for that Banshee to flash out of the way of it. Didn't actually need to, but on reaction.
Yeah, it's they really didn't want to risk getting caught there, though, because Hiryu and Amumu there could have possibly, like, killed all three of them, and that was just the worst case outcome. I mean, right now Graves is pretty much on a par, like, with Ezreal. I mean, there's 2 assists on Ezreal and 3 CS he's got on him. They're very, very similar in terms of where they are with their builds right now. That being said, though, Ernex looks like he's going for an Infinity Edge earlier, and Ezreal has gone for maybe more of a mid-game oriented build with the Trinity Force. So, yeah, maybe Ernex is sort of either on a par or slightly ahead, maybe. But regardless, there's not a huge difference between them. And yeah, if Ezreal had gotten, you know, a double or a triple kill there, that would have been disastrous. But, so, right now, the key players basically are going to be Jax and Gragas, I think, really, honestly, for WinFact. And kind of Irelia and Amumu, I think, on GM Gaming?
DM,
right. Consonant M.
Yes.
Yeah.
This is the format.
Wait, no. Yeah. So, yeah, they'll be taking that mid tower for free, actually, yeah. Karthus just wasn't in position right then, after that blue contest. Nothing doing.
Well, 2 towers for Zero at the moment, and they're being very aggressive, potentially looking for the 5-man gank on bottom, which they are responding with. Tower on very low HP, so if they do go for that dive, they can have someone committed to that tower, which will be Graves in this case. Ultimate going down from the Hiryu, will be popping out there with the Arcane Shift. Massive damage coming out onto Taric and picking up kill up immediately. 2 for 0 and the turret, being very, very aggressive. Fanix needs to be very careful here, he could be sausaged. And Banish Toss goes in, will be missing. Snowball goes down into the body flop as well. Emoko looking for the stun. And Curse of the South Moon goes out along with Dante's Revolution. Arcagod's right in the middle of it, looking to die in the middle of them to do more damage. NX will be taking that charge for a split second. And the Requiem goes down. Will he reclaim any kills? Oh, six will go down. And the rest of them. That was very nearly a penta.
Want to buy a rearm. Like, that is horrible in your carpus. Like, oh, there's so many kills I could get if only I was just this tiny bit more fed. And speaking of fed, actually, Elmopo, 4-0 right now with 156 farm. He is probably the richest player.
I wouldn't be surprised.
7,300, yeah. No, Gragas is actually ahead of him on gold right now.
Oh, wow.
Partly because of the Cage's lucky pick, mostly because of his ridiculous amount of farm. Are pulling ahead in gold right now, in fact. They're not hugely ahead. And there is a serious danger of them getting kind of out AoE'd. They do have a disengage, though. They have Kowtar. They have Explosive Cask, which can really screw over any Mumu initiating. Because you can just kind of... He goes in, he ults, then you ult them all the way, so they can't follow up on that AoE root stun thing that a Mumu does. I still don't actually know what it is.
It's a thing. It's in a class of all of its own. It's very odd.
Yeah,
it doesn't stop you auto-attacking, but it stops abilities, but it roots you, but it doesn't stop you as a stun. Confusing.
It's like they got an intern to program that one thing, and he didn't know how to do the standard way, so he just programmed in his own stun.
Yeah. It's like, can anyone help me with this? And it's just like, everyone was on holiday, so it's just like, bleh, meh.
Well, I'll just do this. Something.
I'll call it a mechanic of a Mumu specifically. It's his gimmick.
Yeah, it's quirks.
Yeah.
This is gameplay.
I like to think that's how it went down in Riot Officers. But this could be the initiate though, Emopo. Our Banatos actually lands straight through that wall. Ooh, that damage from Gragas's Q. Do a barrel roll.
Yeah, right now we're hitting kind of peak Gragas. Like, he is hitting the point where his base abilities on his damage are... The base damages on his abilities are hitting kind of their highest point, and he also has, like, his largest kind of AP to, like, level ratio. Like, right now he is doing huge damage. And actually, Winfect going for a timing push on Baron here. They know it isn't warded. They can clear it very fast with their team composition. They have a lot of damage, and yeah, DM isn't reacting.
Well, they are reacting, but they're tanky enough to do it, and they're just going to turn around looking for the engage more than anything. There's the ultimate from Gragas into the Disgust Sad Mummy as well. Brother putting down the ultimate along with Ghost will be picked up. However, ultimate goes down, and Requiem potentially looking for some kills right here. Agnes forced to back off along with Six, throwing him into the Baron Pit. And Elmopo trading off with Brother, but he probably can't win this because of very low health will be picked up by the Blade Surge, and that will be the ace. That was a fight that they wanted, but... that's the fight that they needed, not the one that they deserved.
Yes, they... the problem was there, they didn't disengage from Baron quite fast enough. They were still tanking it somewhat when a movement came in, and also it was a very kind of messy Kowtard ultimate. Like, he actually ulted before a Mumu did. So, his ultimate didn't really spread them out in the way that they wanted to, and they ended up actually getting a lot of their guys picked off. Graves was being kind of stuck to, as I recall, by... who was it? Someone was sticking to him. I couldn't tell you, actually, but... And yeah, obviously, Baron really does do a lot of damage at this stage of the game, and also puts an attack damage debuff on you. So if you're tanking Baron, you do a lot less damage and take more. And yeah, generally, it's a one-way ticket to losing that team fight.
Also wanted to comment on Jax's build, because I saw it before and I never really got the chance to because there's so many things happening. But, they're actually going for it again? Okay. I mean, they saw Ezreal down there with the amazing warding cover, I have to say, all over the map right now. But is this another fight that they want? I guess all their cooldowns are going to be, or because they have very short cooldowns. Brother potentially being on the receiving end of a lot of their bursts. Twisted Castle only hits one person, that being a Mumu. Mumu's ultimate is definitely not going to be up, and Jax is ripping into their carries. He does have the Guardian Angel right now as well. Not a high priority target. Brother coming back in, looking for the kill on Zen. Like, not going to get to Nasty Ward, also looking to peel as well. Elmopo has been popped into Guardian Angel, he's back up immediately, popping down the Counter-Strike as well, stunning onto Hiryu and Fennec picking up the kill, and Dance Revolution goes down. They will be popping over that wall. Ghost coming in from the side as well with that Ice Ball, and Arcagon in that bush. He knows he's there trying to juke. Pops down the ultimate as well, not picking up the kill. He will survive with about 33 health, and Six coming in from the side as well. Does not have enough mana for the Hymn of Valor. Body flop goes down, and looking for that ultimate, finally picking that one up. and that will be a 2-for-2 trade overall. No, 2-for-3 because Kovacs is still in his death form.
Yeah, it's interesting because, as you say, it might well have been a matter of cooldowns there. Forcing that fight then, Amumu's ultimate was still slightly on cooldown, I think. It was just running out as the fight kind of continued. So it was, really, really nice play, actually. Like, this is one of the things that I think the Korean teams do as well, which is they keep track of everything. They keep track of summoner spells, they keep track of ultimates, they keep track of, you know, huge quantities of information. And by doing that, it allows you to really, really make your own timing opportunities. Like, last fight, they lost because they had that Amumu ult taking out a lot of their guys from the fight. So in this fight, it wasn't up. So that same situation that they forced almost, you know, a minute later, really, really, really worked out a lot better for them.
Yeah, and it's kind of mind play as well, because they went straight for it, and it's just like, oh, what, they're doing it again? They're going to die again. But they didn't factor everything that win fact factored into it. By being the aggressor, by starting things, it makes you think about whether you can win it, but being reactive to it, and actually, that being said, Arcagod will be picked up immediately by that huge burst from Windfact. And that is one key play. And Wuffle also in mid, doing some damage on the two. Brother is going to pop onto that minion with Blaze Surge onto Elmwuffle once again. Has popped the ultimate as well for an increased resistance. Hiryu coming from that as well. Very little Elmwuffle can do. Flash goes out as well, looking for the ward jump perhaps, juking him out of the way. Good Q and pops down the counter strike once again. Will be stunning. That's actually Revolution goes down and jumping over to a minion as well. Phanix looking for the kill. And there's a true shot of Rod picking that one up as he was moving in the straight line. Brother also picked up. Phanix coming over the wall with a bandage toss and popping down the curse of the sad mummy, but kind of just to save himself more than anything, and he will eventually be picked up. Here are you popping the arcane shift over the wall, and that was 3-for-1. So Elmwuffle led them around in circles long enough for the rest of the team to catch up.
Yeah, that was really, really good play by Elmwuffle. I mean, he ended up dying for it, and I think it was actually unintentional that he got caught, but the way he led them around, he actually kept them in a situation where they couldn't quite get away. Like, they committed so many resources to killing Elmwuffle that they needed to finish him off. But if they didn't do it correctly, which they ended up not doing...
Oh, Karthus holds him against Alan. Nasty would potentially be picked up. Fat Man to the face. Lunu will actually be picked up by Hiryu as well. And Arkangod going out with the Wall of Pain. Maybe from Kanto Initiate actually to jump into them. And Exhaust goes down. The Kanto is still chasing after Hiryu. Completely out of mana, but the auto attacks alone from Drunken Raid. Extra damage. Six also coming in from the side, just offering the auto attacks. Etnex getting his Duke Shoes on. And that would be the kill from the Six. Just from the side, getting that power core down. And Gragas still chasing after Hiryu, will be the shutdown, being a bit too aggressive without the mana in 6, just trying to offer all the support he can. But Elmwuffle back into the fray.
Yeah, that was interesting. But yeah, from that Elmwuffle chase before, he led them into a situation where they were still using their cooldowns when the rest of the team arrived. So they ended up actually being at a disadvantage. And it looks like Fanix and Breda are just going to be picking up a quick dragon while before the constant Baron attempts resume. It seems like WinFact's, you know, their playstyle here really wants them to be going for these fights, and I'm not really sure why, because they have probably... I don't know, actually, they have very strong AoE themselves, I guess. It's interesting. I feel like they would do in many ways better to be forcing tower fights, where they can have a wide open area and they can make better use of Gragas' ultimate and spread out the enemy. But, you know, maybe not. Right now, Gragas is 476 AP. He's taken a blue elixir, and he's actually holding one in store as well. He's going to be... what? How much cooldown reduction does he have right now? 14%. So, with the blue buff, that's going to be 34%. Yeah, he'll be getting his ultimate down to about 52, 3, 4 seconds. Cooldown, and if you compare that to Amumu, if they can force a fight, Amumu blowing his ult, and then they just disengage, they can fight again very soon with all their ultimates back up again, and Amumu won't have his. But, I'm slightly surprised that Amumu hasn't gone for a Frozen Heart in that
I was just gonna say, I took the words out of my mouth, but yeah, it would make a lot of sense.
Because Frozen Heart is a very nice item. It gives you mana, it gives you cooldowns, it gives you armor, it gives you an amazingly powerful aura. Especially against a team like this, actually, where, you know, Elmwuffle and Etnex will both be severely gimped by that attack speed debuff in an AoE around them. I just don't see why he's gone for a Sunfire Cape over that. I mean, I guess he needs the health in order to himself alive more, but that Frozen Heart is just so good on him.
Yeah, and it's kind of mitigate what they're trying to push forward. It's mitigating the fact that they're going for these team fights when they have stuff on cooldown, and this looks like a Shirelia's push as well. Emperor coming in with the counter-strike, lands on two people. Iryu being pushed out of the fight as well. Ghost potentially being picked up. NX is getting torn apart by the bruiser. Dantex of Revolution goes down. The Flash by Brother will pick him up. And Reckon coming down, looking for the kill on to the rest of the team, but Elmopo will be popped into the Guardian Angel form. Brother still chasing around, and there's the flash into a Moomoo, taking him out with that tantrum. And the rest of the team will be backing off, and the rest of the team only being Elmopo, so we will be moving on to the Baron.
Just take the advantage to push a bit, I think. Elmopo is... Oh, maybe he's actually going to go in. Pretty risky.
It is, considering Baron's on, like, no health.
Yeah. It's just like a Taric stun. Yeah. There. No.
No.
No. Yeah, that was just odd. I don't understand why he went in there. Like, it was just. You should have known he was just going to get Taric stunned and nuked down. Like, he couldn't stun before Taric, essentially. Like, if he jumps with a counter strike, Taric stun hits him in midair, they both get stunned, he's going to be dead before Taric dies. And 4-on-1. You're not Jax enough on that front.
Not enough of Jax. Yeah. And plus he didn't have Smite. He didn't have like that true damage which can just instantly go out for. He's not... I guess what he was looking for was to jump in with Counter-Strike, stun them all, maybe to be low enough HP where Baron can help him out as well, but... I mean, he is 8-3, and okay, he has Guardian Angel, but... He is looking actually to build probably the build towards Cutlass. Because something I wanted to comment on before I got really interrupted by a teamfight was the fact that usually what you'll see is a Jax going for the build towards Cutlass, leaving it at that, going for the Trinity Force and maybe like a Guardian Angel afterwards. But he kind of forwent the build towards Cutlass, which he's just picked up right now, in fact, to actually go for the Trinity Force immediately, because he picked up at 18 minutes, and then he went straight for the Guardian Angel, because he was so fed, he wanted to make himself a high-priority target with that Guardian Angel, so they'd be forced to focus him, but then he could just jump right back into it, and he'd be tanking more by still being a bruiser. But now he is picking up the build towards Cutlass.
I've got to say, actually, in that last team fight, I suspect a large proportion of what went wrong there was Moomoo managed to jump in, essentially, and get onto Etnex with Irelia. I mean, that put Etnex in a horrible position, right? But then Kowtard exacerbated it by not ulting. He didn't... Like, he ulted to help Jax, essentially. He helped, ulted the Karthus, the Ezreal, to keep them sort of, you know, occupied while they exhausted Jax. But at that precise moment, Etnex had Irelia on him, literally on him, and Amumu was also there as well, damaging him, bringing him down. Etnex is probably their biggest damage source right now, even including Jax, because Jax has built very, very tanky. He was in a situation where he could tie up multiple members of the enemy team and die, but I think he would have been better served if Kowtard...
Here's the potential initiation, though, but the counter initiation from the other Sorelli is good on the receiving end of a lot of the burst, and the good ultimate with explosive cast, and Sixth Evolution goes straight onto Arcagod, but Hiryu will be unstoppable, Six wasting that bush, and will be... Oh, hey, award. And now, Six is not in a great position. just have a Taric
well,
after him.
Awkward.
And now he's probably going to try and execute himself. He is very fast, though, with his aura, that being the E. And ping goes down. They are looking to tag him. Oh, Jukes! Six knows he probably can't get to the... He has been tagged. But he's trying to get out now, though.
Run, yeah.
Oh. He hasn't been phaged, Proctus yet.
Oh, dear.
Karthus board.
Karthus says nope.
And nope. Ezreal says nope to Karthus by just picking up the kill. So I've just used Requiem. I'll be kill securing that and not giving you an assist. Thank you.
Nice guy.
Good
nice
guy, guy, here are you. But... Bounce shots over the walls around to Elmopo. Stun goes down, and there's the flash. He just wants to stay alive.
Yeah, the Winfact keeps getting kind of picked off. Like, they're not forcing the fights they want, really. And they do, I will admit, have to deal with a very strong composition now. I mean, they're hitting late game. This is a very powerful AoE they've got going on here. They've got Amumu, they've got Karthus, they've got Ezreal and Taric, and Irelia will pick off anyone, basically, at the back. So, they've got to do something to avoid having Graves focused out. And honestly, their problem, in many ways, I think, is they don't have someone to deal with Irelia. If El Mupo jumps into the duel the enemy carries, then he's gonna get screwed over, basically. He's not as tanky as Aurelia. He'll get melted down a little bit faster. I think he just... It's a difficult conundrum for them. They need to focus out Aurelia. They need to somehow get Aurelia completely separate. And maybe they're just not being well suited by these 5v5 teamfights. If they get a pick
Nasty would body flop straight after, instant collateral damage just to tag him. And El Mupo coming in from the side as well. Fanix potentially looking for the curse of Seth Money. And Jizex Revolution goes down, and there it is, landing on four people, but they will quickly be out of that. Now jumping onto Fanix as well, picking up that kill. This is a shutdown, 2-0 trade so far, more of a pick. And now they were pushing down that turret. That is the pick they needed.
Yeah, this is precisely what I was just saying, actually. The 5v5 teamfights aren't suiting them, but they do have very, very strong duelists. You know, they have Graves, who is probably, at this stage, one of the better AD carries in that scenario, in that kind of, like, one-on-one, two-on-two.
For Brella coming in as well, El Mupo has popped the counter-strike. Ox got taking huge damage, actually, from Kaltod. Flashes in so he can die to deal more damage, but they are running away at this point. Rekum goes down, picking up the kill onto... Wow! Who? How? It looked like one, but everyone was down to about one hit. And Six now chasing after Brother, but he really can't win against him. At least he saved Etnix, but that would be the free trade. El Mupo just in the jungle, and our Brother is on the hunt.
All it's going to take is one blade search. Counter-Strike will not save El Mupo right now, but he's away, so it's all good for him. I'm just going to go and push out that lane. That was unfortunate. WinFact knew they had only a temporary advantage there. They knew they'd gotten that pick onto Nasty Wood, and they knew they had to make something of it then, because they've noticed that they're losing these 5-on-5s. So, they were a bit too aggressive about it. They took damage from the tower in order to try and take it down. And they did do significant damage to it, but they didn't take it out, and they did end up kind of not really winning the second fight. But that's sort of shown the way forward for them. They need to get picks. They need to get, you know, a guy out of the fight before the fight begins. And obviously the same kind of suits Team DM. Damn it, I will never remember. they will never... Team DM doesn't really have quite the same picking power, I guess. They're more focused on that AoE team fight than WinFact.
Yeah, that being said, they have Nasty Wood with the Dazzle and then into Fanix Banzer's Chance. I mean, it is a lockup, I guess.
It's pretty good CC, but it's not as inescapable as a Nunu.
Yeah, that's true. Then again, they do have the Wall of Pain, but Brother looking to lead the charge straight into the enemy team. Counter-Strike goes in, looking more to peel this time. Kaltar popping down the ultimate, being the explosive cast, jumping out. Brother still jumping onto NX's face. When he goes down by Ghost, trying to zone some people, and here you will be picking that one up and now joining the rest of the team. And Wuppa will be picked off with Six and Kaltar and NX on the back foot. Rekum goes down, can push them back and pop NX into the Guardian in. Not gonna happen, 20 health. Cut heal from Six. Well, this will be the mid push. Can Gragas counter initiate and counter engage? That is the question. Gragas has a lot of counter pushing power, and they're actually retreating right now to Baron.
Yeah, Gragas. They're going to take this Baron, and they think it's free, but I'm not so convinced that it actually is. Gragas has very, very strong poke. So long as he doesn't get engaged upon, so long as they keep those wards going.
Okay, but that's not actually going to happen until very, very quickly, and it has actually been hit by the slow. The castle is still being chased after, and maybe picked up. Yeah, that is a flash actually picked by Hiryu, and that will be a kill. And that's a flash for a kill at this stage of the game. It is very, very useful, and actually two-shot barrage going down bottom just to stop that push.
Yeah, it's looking bad right now for WinFact. They keep losing men, they keep losing these teamfights, and now the enemy has Baron too, so that's only going to exacerbate the problem. Now they can regen all day, now they can siege all day. Etnex does have his Guardian Angel, and Aurelia has knocked it down now though, so they do have an advantage in that regard, and I don't know when El Mupo's is coming up. No, not for a while yet. So, it's awkward for them, very awkward indeed. They need to start other lanes pushing out, and maybe get a pick on Hiryu here. El Mupo going in, he's going to...
He will be arcane shifting over the wall though, but yeah, El Mupo coming out with the counter-strike, Etnex coming in as well, and that is a dead Ezreal.
Greedy Ezreal, basically, going for the red buff, which really ought not to have done then. It was just too risky. WinFact are going to try and push now. they know they have to, essentially. They know that they really need to be making something of this right now.
Yeah. So the rest of the team just pushing down mid and 4v5 right now. But as you said before, it was the fact that they were so aggressive last time and that didn't pay off for them. So they're a bit dubious about doing that again.
Yeah. Yeah, actually a lot of what they've done wrong this game, though, I feel was centered around those earlier Baron pushes. Like that first one. I mean, that second one came out better for them, but that first one where they I mean, maybe it was part of the plan to use the cooldowns then, but I really think they could have used best dangerous methods of using that because they had that earlier game advantage. But now we're hitting the point where Karthus is becoming really dangerous. He's becoming Karthus. I mean, Lay Waste is hitting for 300. If it hits a single target, it's doubled, so it's nearly 600 damage every 0.6 seconds. That's a lot. That is
if you can't do maths, that's a lot of damage.
like 600 damage. Let's look at Graves' health. He has 2,000 health. He does have 84 magic resist. I will grant that. So he's reduced by something. I don't know exactly how much. Probably maybe half that damage, maybe? No. That would be too much. Regardless, he's taking in the region of 400 to 500 damage every 0.6 seconds if that's landing on him. That will chunk him down in 5 shots, maybe? 5-6 shots? 7 maybe, at most? And that's completely ignoring his Defile, that's completely ignoring the Wall of Pain Reduction, Requiem, all that damage. Archagod is, you know, so much damage right now. Whereas Kowtard, he has more burst. He has more burst than Karthus. He's doing nearly 1,000 damage with his Explosive Cask. He's doing 600 damage with Barrel Roll, but his cooldowns are much longer. He's not going to be able to output anything like the same damage. Well, that was a fight.
Oh, this could be it. And Emwopo going in. Dazzle is down at the moment, looking to do some damage to Emwopo before he jumps in. He is one of the strongest members of the team right now. Also, jumping back to your point, is basically when you get to the stage where Kowtard's greater burst is less than what Archgod can put out during the course of a sustained team fight, you're kind of in trouble because he's always going to deal more damage than you and it's only going to get worse. That's the issue. But that being said, Kowtard can put it onto a specific target. That being said, again, you also have Archgod being able to pinpoint damage onto who he wants to hit.
There is that utility from the Explosive Cask, but right now, Raider getting cock-blocked by a minion, but there's a... their Baron buff just ran out. Now is basically, I would say, Winfact's last chance to shine, essentially. Their team comp, I don't think it will win late game, essentially. I think the Amumu Karthus is far too strong late game, and if they don't do something now, basically, they won't win in the future. Like, unless they can pull off something incredible later on. I mean, it's certainly always possible. You can always get that pick that wins you the game, but like, this is really their time to shine. Amumu is going to be looking in. Oh, nearly hitting 6 there. Though if he had, he might have actually gotten killed by the Kowtard Etnex combo, but I don't know. Certainly, every lane, they're trying. Both teams are now really trying to get all three lanes, pushing out as hard as they possibly can. As many members of their team. Wow, 3 Guardian Angels, in fact. They really don't want to get anyone focused out. They really want to force a team fight that they can win. They want to get a pick. They want to keep their lanes pushing. But at the same time, they know they probably can't engage in a 5v5 unless it's favorable. So it's this constant juggling of having their team go top, having their team go bottom, but at the same time, not getting hard engaged on, not getting a Mumu in on them. You know, and actually Mumu's picked up a Frozen Heart now, by the way. Wow! Mumu's armor is 345 armor.
Wow!
That is... Wow. Whoa, that is crazy.
Oh, Taric buff is... Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That's mental armor. Ezreal just using his ultimate to Well, this is what I mean about this keeping the lanes pushing. This is so crucial right now. They have to keep their lanes forcing the enemy to be in 4-on-5. Like I say, it's so crucial for them. You know, it's incredibly hard to do, because obviously if anyone, any one individual person gets caught unawares, any one person gets killed, they will die, basically.
Yeah. And I guess it's all about that next team fight. Like, they know that it's like down next team fight, if they win it, they win. If they lose it, they lose. That team fight decides the game. And that's why they've gone for the Guardian Angel, because the Guardian Angel will win them that team fight potentially. And because the Sad Mummy goes down, and Muppet trying to zone them out, Guardian Angel will be popped immediately. Zansex Revolution onto four people, knockback as well. Beetle War Explosive Cast goes for surely be popped up in the second. Reckon goes down as well, straight onto El Muppo. Will be picking up a kill onto Ghost. Brother coming back in with the Blaze Surge, two kills immediately. That'll be 3-4-1 trade so far. Etnex surely going to be picked up. He will be surviving. Six coming in from the side as well. Be flashing out. And Brella coming in with the Blade Surge into the Banjo shot as well. Great pick. And that is probably the game.
Yeah, I'm afraid they just lost that fight. It was just what I said. That's so strong AoE. And they just couldn't. They ended up fighting in a 5-on-5. They couldn't win. They should have probably waited more for a pick if they could, but
they got engaged upon. That was the issue.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that will just clean up at the moment, unless Etnex can pull off some god mode save. I can't see it happening. Brez is going to jump onto him. Yeah, GG.
Yeah,
well played.
GG. Ah, well, that was that final team fight there was really well played, actually. DM. Yeah, very well played. And you can see, wow, actually, 16.6k gold on three members. That's amusing. That was just that power of that AoE composition. And it turned out in the end that Gragas's disengage just wasn't really strong enough. Maybe if they'd had a Janna support instead of a Sona, that could have worked out for them. But no, it didn't happen in the end.
Yeah.
Well played.
Yeah, it was just amazing, the fact that they got that turnaround in the game and they just maintained the advances and they really just went to those team fights that they could win. They were all, every time WinFact was on the aggressive push, then they punished them for it, and every time they saw someone slightly out of position, they forced that team fight in a favourable position. And when WinFact were being aggressive, they were being aggressive around objectives, but DM Gaming will be aggressive on their players when they were grouped up as a team and trying to force them into a position where they didn't really want to be going for that fight. In the last team fight, they went straight onto the Jax, and Jax didn't really want to fight. He didn't want to run away either, because they wanted that fight anyway, and he was just like, oh, what do we do? And he was forced to commit a commitment that they didn't want to make, which, yeah. But anyway, guys, we're going to jump to a quick break once again, and when we get back, we'll be in the next round. So anyway, guys, stay tuned for more great League of Legends action. See you soon.